So let's start with a round of applause, please. I like this. This is a very agreeable crowd. Nobody thought why. But why? Because India last year briefly was the sixth largest economy in the world in July of last year, till again we lost it to France. But the good news is this year, IMF predicts that we will again retain the spot, the sixth spot. But what the government of India, and this is from a news clipping few days back, is saying that we will be a $10 trillion economy. Mind you, today we are $2.69 trillion economy. So we are looking at a fourfold increase in a span of a little over a decade. The vision is to reach 2030, $10 trillion, and by 2025, $5 trillion. These are huge numbers. How are we going to go there? The clap was for yourself. You are the people who made us achieve this position. Your work contributed to the GDP of the country. So I made you all clap for yourself. What Dr. Vahia said, respect yourself. It's an achievement. Everybody did something to contribute to that number. So how do we go about achieving 2030, $10 trillion economy, becoming the world's third largest economy? So that's the entire presentation that I'm going to go through. The agenda, I'll just give you brief definitions. What is optimizing? What is productivity? What is work? Then we are going to look at how do we, or why does productivity matter? How do we measure productivity and what we can do to optimize productivity at an individual level, at an organizational level, as well at a national level? And of course, you all are free to speak on the phone, do WhatsApp, Facebook, mail, Twitter. I have no reservation, as long as you don't violate the sanctity of this room and disturb your neighbors. So coming to definitions over here. So this is something very standard. Optimizing, in very plain Hindi, kitna deti hai, you know, there was this Maruti advertise, kitna deti hai. You want the maximum mileage out of a given liter of petrol. So the best or the most effective use of a situation of resource. Productivity, it's a ratio of volume measure of output to the measure of input. So how many hours of input, the work you are giving in, and what is your output? How much of value you are adding, or what is the output given by that particular person? And work is composed of actions that are using tools in a systematic way and is societally organize. And in fact, work differentiates humans from animals. Even animals use tool, but it's not societally organized. Having this basic definitions clear, let's go on to see why productivity matters. And let's go back a little back in time, a little over 2,000 years in time. Well, this chart shows the world GDP almost from 2 millennia. And at right at the bottom over there, if I can show you all over here, when we were an agrarian society, you can see there was hardly any GDP, almost till the Industrial Revolution began in the late 1700s. It was mainly agriculture driven. Then this Industrial Revolution over here, with the invention of the steam engine, and you can see there is an uptick in the global GDP. And of course, then you had the first industrial, second industrial, and now some people say it's the sixth industrial revolution. In the 60s and 70s, we had what is known as the IT and the IoT revolution, the Internet of Things. And today you look at the global GDP, it's over $100 trillion. This is the data. And you can see all this progress coming in simply because of an industrial revolution. At the same time, you can see this is the distribution of the GDP across the countries in the world. It's more for the Americas, the North Americas, Western Europe, some Middle East nations, and Australia. The darker the color, the higher is the per capita GDP. And you see sub-Saharan Africa, India, these are much less. So there is a disparity in the global contribution. At an individual level, if we look, how would GDP matter? Or productivity matter. Generally, higher the individual productivity, more likely are the gains, both tangible and intangible. Dr. Vahia said that do something which gives you happiness. if you do something which gives you satisfaction, and definitely something which gives you a better productivity, brings in more satisfaction, a fruit vegetable vendor, when he's able to sell more fruit, not only gets more money, but if he really likes it, he gets more happiness because he has been able to make people happy over there. A farmer who's producing more crop, not only feels happy because he's taking him home more money, but because he's feeding in more mouths over there. At an organizational level, so over here it's slightly different. Usually productivity translates to profit, but mind you, it needs an investment. So sometimes there is a higher investment to bring about an increase in productivity. So it's not directly proportional. And at a national level, improved total GDP contributes to development of the nation. India today is not the same as it was 20 years ago, definitely not the same as when it was independent. So you can see definitely the development. We have malls, we have so many new cars on the road. All that is a reflection of the GDP. Of course, it's still unequal. You have some sections of the society which are having a higher productivity compared to others. And that inequality is causing the problem. But overall, when the GDP of the nation improves, the per capita income improves, the national GDP improves, and nations develop in this particular fashion. So having seen why productivity matters, a word about how do we measure productivity. Of course, this is much beyond the scope of this session. The OECD, the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, has a manual. And in fact, there are two measures of productivity. You have a unifactor and a multifactor productivity measure. The unifactor actually measures the labor productivity. Over here, it's either in the form of number of hours that they input or the value which is added. And labor productivity is the most sensitive measure of quality of life in that given country. The higher the labor productivity, you know that higher is the quality of life in that given country. On a multi-factor front, you have different factors. You can tease out if the capital, the investment, the labor, or other intermediaries were responsible. And in fact, this is used by analysts to know what was the past growth pattern and forecast what is the future growth pattern. I'm not going to go into details of this, but the point is there are measures. Economists are in a better position to measure all this, but to give you an idea that productivity is actually measurable. Having known this, let's see what can we do to optimize productivity. In general, investment. So you know that our government is encouraging foreign direct investment. Why? We need the investment not only in equipment, we need it in manpower, we need it in facilities. This is definitely a tool. We need the money, we need the know-how to improve the productivity in our own country. Secondly, innovation, process and product innovation. What do I mean by a process innovation? So let's say a farmer who is sowing his soil using the bullock cart. He's only able to sow maybe this much area in one day. But if he has a tractor and he's able to sow the whole field, that is an innovation for the farmer. The product innovation, the live example is, I'm not carrying any laptops or pen drive. I have my phone and I use that to present this. So that's a product innovation. The iPhone revolutionized the way we are communicating. We had various lectures throughout this series on the ill effects of social media, but used positively like this, it's going to really benefit the society. Skills, most of the companies, organizations, universities want to employ people with higher qualification. No wonder everybody wants to pursue a PhD, a postgraduate degree, et cetera, experience, and everybody wants to upgrade their skills because that directly translates into a higher productivity for that individual, for the organization, and for the country. Enterprise. So over here, what I mean by enterprise is the quality of the management team, the agility, the speed with which they adapt, and the organizational culture. These matter in general for productivity in a given organization. And lastly, competition. I won't go into details, but to tell you very simply, remember the time when Jio did not enter the market, and what was the price you were paying for accessing a voice call for the data. And imagine after Jio entered the market, how good it was for you. And today, sitting here, you can access your mail, you can access whatsoever, And that has actually improved your productivity. You can be attending my lecture at the same time. You can be focusing on your work, giving important decisions. So definitely, competition brings out the best. And not only that, it's known that in a given individual, the performance improves in front of a crowd, unless, of course, this individual is having some phobias of a crowd. Having seen this, let's go to the bulk of this presentation. How do we improve the individual productivity? And in that, I have listed 8 factors: psychological and physical health status, which I will delve into a little bit detail, time management, prioritizing over here, reducing distractions, delegating, goal setting, skills, and attitude. This is where I'm going to spend most of my time in this talk. Coming to health, there's this notion, they say health is wealth, and it's not without a reason. You know, today, what is the number one killer in our country? It's in fact, stress and depression is one, but even more worrying than that, cardiac arrest. Somebody said diabetes, I heard. Yes. Diabetes, we are one of the global leaders of diabetes. It's a silent killer. And you know why? Because it starts at an early age, but the full effects or side effects of the illness, if I can say, are only in the 50s. So somebody, imagine some person who's starting an organization over here in his late 20s and 30s. By the time he's 50, he's reaching the post of VP and president. Unfortunately, this guy is having kidney problems related to diabetes, either dies or has to go for dialysis, cannot be productive at work. And Indians, obesity is increasing. Diabetes is an epidemic globally, but India is one of the diabetic capital of the world. And this is where, actually, over here, if we look at health, I will explain the other aspects, but in terms of ill health, diabetes is one of it. Somebody said depression. It's the number two. Depression, as per the WHO, has a lot of disability life adjusted years. So the number of days lost due to the illness, productivity is very high with depression. In fact, one of the top 5 causes. And both of these are a double whammy for our country. And our youth today are in the worst position. They have access to fast food. What Dr. Vahia said, they are in a sort of a rat race, even if we are humans. And they are just running behind something which they don't know. So stress is there, diabetes is there, they have bad sleeping habits, bad eating habits, no exercises, and eventually the health is suffering. In fact, an important component of health is sleep. Dr. Vahia very rightly mentioned that you need 8 hours of sleep, full stop. Maybe 6 hours to 8 hours, but one needs to have quality sleep. One needs to devote time for oneself. We need to have some time for ourselves. We need to eat something which is nutritious for us, not just giving us calories. Even alcohol gives us calories. In fact, a very high calorie, but it's not at all nutritious. For that matter, junk food also is very high. It gives us an instant kick, but it's not really, really good. I won't go into the details why that is the case, but simply, it's not giving us the nutrients we need. And this is causing a lot of ill health. And of course, stress, on which Dr. Vahia gave an elaborate discussion. Over here, you see all the different psychiatric disorders, of which the most important ones and the most prevalent, the common cold of psychiatry, anxiety disorder, and depression, are really eating away productivity. Somebody who's subclinically depressed, you see a lot of these articles in the newspapers, they call the smiling depression, what we call as dysthymia, and it actually hampers the productivity. The individual is an underachiever throughout his life. You meet this guy, he's a brilliant guy, and you wonder, why is he here? Why is he not there? It's because of this dysthymia. Moving on to time management. If somebody said, what's the most precious thing one would have? It's actually time. Even in Mahabharat, when I watched it on the TV, they said, samay se jyada balwan koi nahi hai, which is very true. How you manage your time decides on how time manages you. And as simple as that, we need to compartmentalize our time. Somebody in the audience said, we need to live in the now, not procrastinate about our past or ruminate about it and worry too much about the future. We have 24 hours in a day. We cannot change anything about it. We need to compartmentalize, okay, 8 hours sleep, 8 hours for myself, leisure, family, and 8 hours for work. I know this is a very idealistic approach that I'm giving, but as far as possible, we can try to compartmentalize and try and organize things in this particular fashion. And subsequently, there will be a lot of chores in the whole day. You land up in the office, you have telephone calls, you have emails, you have people running after you, giving you their work, what they call monkey on my back. And you are like, how do I do everything? You want to please everybody. And what Dr. Vahia very rightly said, you must please yourself, not please others. And that really eats away our time. And finally, it's fashionable. Time nahi hai. Time nathi mari paase. We all wear watches. And when somebody says time nahi hai, I say, you have a watch. Why do you say you don't have time? And that's because we are not prioritizing. There is this matrix of priority. Anybody has been exposed to this priority matrix? Some people have. Would you all want to explain, or would you like me to do that honors? I can give you the mic.
So whatever are the things to do, they are to be categorized into four topics. First is necessary and urgent. Second is important and urgent. Second is important, not urgent. Third is not important but urgent. And fourth is not urgent and not important.
Exactly.
So what we have to give the most priority to whatever is high on importance and high on urgency. So those chores have to be done first. And in that order, you have to go to the decreasing order of like the first, the redder one, then the orange one, then the green one. So you can plan your time.
Perfect, ma'am. So exactly, is this task important and is this task urgent? If we start dividing tasks into those particular aspects, so we'll soon realize that what is the risk of not doing this task, what is the urgency for doing this task, and what is the impact of doing this task. And accordingly, we can put them in these four squares. So for example, a crisis or something which is deadline driven, do them first, because if they have an urgency and they have a high importance, that is the task one should be attending to. Next is the task which has low urgency but a very high importance, and most of the time this is what really gives us progress. And often we don't spend time over here. This is actually the thing which we do need to do is plan. But what we'll end up doing is over here what we call the firefighting. So somebody walks into the office and says, okay, please sort this out problem for me. Actually, it's his problem which he's giving it to you. It's not your problem. So it's actually a very high urgency, but very low importance for you. And we'll end up doing those tasks and we feel a huge burnout. And that's what Dr. Vahia said. We're doing things for others, not for ourselves. And finally, over here, neither is it urgent, neither is it important. Just put it under the carpet, don't even bother about it. You'll have lots of emails, lots of phone calls, lots of gossips. They all belong over here. Do things which matter. How many of us are just now focusing on the top part of the screen? Well, that's because it's a distraction. And that's what is really happening. Over here also, if you're looking at your phone, maybe it's a distraction. If you're looking around, when is this lecture going to end? That's a sign of boredom, a distraction. And actually, studies have found that most of the time, we spend in gossiping, chatting, social media, while we are working. In short, we are trying to multitask. And factually, most of us are not built to multitask. We think that we can do a multitasking, but we are not able to do. The simple reason is the front part of the brain, that's the one which does the executive functioning. Everything is in a queue. So all your thoughts, everything is in a queue. And the moment you have diverted your attention onto something else, you disrupt, you break the link between your different chain of thoughts. And invariably, you land up skipping one of them, and you forget completely. And then when you come back to it, it's too late. So most of us are not built for multitasking. Office gossips, somebody making noise, even that distracts. So distraction is a real hamper for productivity. Delegate. Otherwise, as this cartoon says, even the king will be drawing the road signs over here. And delegation is a very powerful tool to build up your team. Define the task, identify the team, empower them, explain to them, monitor their progress, and then subsequently give them a feedback. That's how delegation works. Each of this topic is itself several hours. I'm just skipping all the details, just telling you that it's important to delegate in order that the productivity improves. Everybody has a team to work with, and unless and until we do not delegate, we are not going to develop the team and we are not going to improve the productivity of the team. Setting goals. If you ask me one thing which actually matters the most is setting goals. Set goals for yourself. Over here, it's a symbolic, literal one in the football. But in life also, we need to measure or set what we call the SMART goals. Specific, measurable, achievable, realistic, and time-based. And even for our team members, we need to keep these kind of goals. Specific, so a salesman needs to have a specific target that I'm going to increase the sales this year by 10 lakhs. And of course, it's measurable, so 10 lakhs is measurable. It's not that I'm going to just increase my sales. By how much, nobody knows. It's achievable. Of course, in the market, you know that this is achievable. If you know that it's only going to increase by 5 lakh and you're telling him to increase by 10 lakhs, it's already done without even starting the job. It's relevant. So if you're giving this target to a salesman, it's relevant. But if you're giving it to a researcher, improve the productivity by 10 lakhs, how does he do it? He can't do it. And it's time-based. Do it in a year span. And finally, you set your goal, you plan it, you monitor it, you adapt yourself, and then you go about achieving your goals. So goal setting is one of the most powerful tools to improve productivity of your teams as well as of your own self. Moving ahead, skills. Well, of course, you know the famous cricketer over here who was inborn with the talent, but even he needed a coach to sharpen his skills. So each one of us has an inherent inborn skills, but the fact is, most of us developed it consciously through training. And the skills can be broadly based into three groups, the cognitive, interpersonal, and intrapersonal. And cognitive is IQ, which is linked to your executive functioning, interpersonal, which is linked to communication, intrapersonal over your team building, and all the skills are the ones which are over here. And we have something called the VUCA world, the volatile, uncertain, complex, and ambiguous. And this is the reality of today, that the world is volatile. What things held yesterday true are no longer valid for today. There's a lot of uncertainty. Regulations keep changing, governments keep changing. Every knowledge that we knew keeps changing. It's complex. If you ask me in medicine, what is the answer? I don't know. I have evidence for and against the question that you will ask me. And sometimes there's a lot of ambiguity. And this is the order of the day. We need to learn to live with this. And for that, we need these 5 Qs. IQ. We are all born with some IQ. The fact is, it is amenable to change by at least 10 to 15 points, by improved nutrition and by environmental stimulation. Emotional quotient, the culture quotient, the digital quotient, and the adversity quotient. And these need to be developed, especially in our children. If our children are facing some problem at their school environment, we should not be intervening. Let them deal with their issues. Let them learn how to overcome their adversity. Digital quotient. We talked a lot about social media. Actually, it's the order of the day. We are going to live with increasing social media. We cannot say that we have to ban social media. We cannot be doing away with social media. We need to live with it. We need to thrive with it. And we need to understand how to make the best use of it. And culture quotient. Today, increasingly, it's a global world. We are not just talking of our country. We need to understand the opposite culture, what are their norms, adapt to them, and work with them. And there can be some nuances, some sensitivities, which we need to understand over here. And of course, emotional quotient, this is something which is already known. We need to empathize with people to be able to pick up the signs on what to say and how to say. Everything else that I said is irrelevant if the attitude is not the correct one. We have n number of leaders, political leaders, organizational leaders who are absolutely brilliant, but the fact is they did not have integrity, they did not have honesty, no respect, and no ethics. And I wouldn't name these people, but you all know them. So what really matters is attitude. Organizations do a thorough check before they employ people. Even the brightest people would undergo sometimes a psychometric analysis before they are employed. For the simple reason, the organizations want to be sure that this individual is having the right attitude. And one of the most frequently used tests is the Big Five, the openness, the conscientiousness, agreeableness, etc. And what really matters over here is the openness to new ideas, new things, conscientiousness, and initiative. So this person is willing to take initiative, much less the agreeableness over here. I mean, if somebody is agreeable, he's not really a good leader because he needs to say what he wants to do. So having seen all this at an individual level, I will just read out for the organizational level, because over here we are at an individual level, how do we improve productivity? But at an organizational level, we need a better IT infrastructure and facilities. A bad worker blames the tools, but it's not necessarily true. Today, we need tools that can really improve our productivity. Most of the car manufacturing plants are employing robots because they want to improve the productivity. Automation is coming in because they want to improve the productivity. So the support team, the HR team, the finance team, they all matter to improve the productivity. Finally, the organization itself needs to have goals. And training, this is the second most important thing to improve productivity. Most of the organizations will give training to improve the skills of the people. And of course, there are various types of training, on-hand training, on-the-go training, as well as officially sending them to different courses. And then the quality of the management team. And at a national level, the policies, infrastructure, and support, these will facilitate the development of individual and organizational productivity. To give a simple example, India is investing heavily into infrastructure, new airports, new ports, new roads. The reason? If we are not connected, how would somebody travel? How would our goods travel? How would communication flow? And without that, our productivity will suffer. So having this three levels of productivity, let us look at some examples. There is this case of an individual whom we have made anonymous, Mr. X, whose productivity improved simply by the fact that he was able to reduce his distractibility and improve his time management. And he could see that really he could do a lot more in a given time of span. There is this organizational example where UPS, this is a logistic company in the US, they had this sophisticated mathematicians who did some complex analysis of the data and found that if their vehicles took only a left turn, not only will they deliver the goods, their courier on time, but they saved billions of dollars just by a simple thing. Most of the UPS men you would not see in the US taking a left turn. They will send them take a left turn. Don't ask me how, it's beyond my understanding, but they did this mathematical equations and found that this is the best way to deliver the goods in the shortest possible time, saving on fuel and improving revenue. And Singapore, that's where I stayed for almost close to a decade. The government is heavily promoting the people to upscale their skills. They are giving credit points. They are giving tax rebates to the people to undergo skills training because they want to improve the productivity at the population level. So finally, after all this, what is the take-home message? If I tell you three things to do at an individual level, practice reducing distraction when you are doing a work. Focus on the task at hand. Do one thing at one time. Set goals for yourself. What are you going to do 1 year, 3 years, 5 years, and 10 years down the line? Prioritize your task. Is it urgent? Is it important? Always put it into this box. If something comes up, is it really something that deserves my attention and time? Or can it be done later? Or can we forget about it? At an organizational level, of course, infrastructure, goal setting, and management team, and at national level, more or less, infrastructure, incentives, and policies. Having said all about productivity, coming to the main point, which I would come back to Dr. Vahia's point, the King of Bhutan was asked, what is the GDP of your nation? And he laughed and said, we don't measure just GDP, we measure the GNP, the gross national happiness. And I found this interesting study from Harvard, in fact, one of the longest studies I have ever come across, an 80-year-old study which followed 238 individuals right from 1938 till date. And what they said is that close relationships more than money or fame are what keep people happy throughout their lives. So ladies and gentlemen, despite being a busy week, Friday evening, y'all are here, what I would suggest is go back home, go back to the people who love you and spend your time over there, because productivity matters, but what really matters is a close relationship. Thank you very much for your attention. Yeah, over here. That one.
Isn't that wonderful? Actually, it is experience.
Okay.
It's experience, wisdom,
this
and simple logic of daily life put into a scientific format. Any questions? Any questions? Yeah, please.
Why this infrastructure?
Because that's one of the parameters of mental health is to regulate your life. If you do not have academics, if you do not have basic pattern of how you manage economy of health and your wealth and your personal life academics, happiness is going to elude you.
And if I can add, actually they have shown that up to a certain income level, happiness is definitely caused due to money. It has a ceiling effect, and this data comes from US, and economists are the ones who... It's $135,000 a year earning, so the happiness improves, but then it plateaus. So there is an obvious link, but it has its limitations.
They say at higher income levels, money doesn't buy happiness, but money buys antidepressant drugs.
We speak into the microphone.
So distraction, as you said, like you meant, I guess, mobile phones and other distractions. So what about while we
try this?
So what about we students while studying, we get distracted, like while studying, we start daydreaming. So so how can we manage that thing?
It's a very good question. You need to identify the time of the day at which is the best for you. Some people find that morning is the best for them. Some people find it's the evening or the afternoon, or some people find it night is the best time for them. Each one needs to find out what is the best time in which they are most productive. In fact, there is this principle of Pareto, which says that 80% of what you do is actually achieved in 20% of the effort and time. So you need to understand, identify which is the best time for you. Do your important task at that given point in time. And when you're doing that task, just block all the things. Block out your cell phone, block out your windows, other noises. Just focus on the task on hand. Of course, this is external, but what about internal? You are having lots of thoughts. And that's where there's the importance of sleep, diet, exercise. It sounds simple and sometimes even silly, that how can these things actually improve your productivity? But exercise has an antidepressant action. Somebody over here, earlier part of the day, said that exercising, just plain walking, an hour in the morning, an hour in the evening, releases what is known as endorphins or feel-good factors in the body. This not only improve your happiness levels, they improve the blood functioning in your body, the vitality in your body, and you could try yoga, meditation to keep focus. And if you're still finding yourself distracted, you need to identify what is it that you are thinking about. Is it some worry? Is it something about the past? Is it something which needs an external help, speaking with your parents, your friends, or a professional help?
There is also something called the Bow effect of attention. The attention kind, you know, the speed at which something that is spoken or read is understood is approximately 80 to 100 words a minute. The speed at which the mind thinks is 600 words a minute. So the speed at which your unconscious mind without effort will think is 600 words a minute. The speed at which that whatever that you are reading is about 100 to 125 words a minute. The speed readers read about 150 words a minute. So in any way you can think faster than you can read or listen. Speak, of course, we can speak fast. So if you're doing some topic of interest, then even your speed of thinking is focused on what you do. Like mothers come and say, when I ask my son to do mathematics or arithmetic, he can't sit for more than 10 minutes. But give him a laptop or a telephone and he can play games for hours together. And because that time that unconscious, the speed at which the person is thinking is focused on the activity that he is doing. So the interest in what you do is good. Most wives contend ki majashi ek shabd bolat nahi ani tyache aishi tasana tas bolat rahto. So it's not that he can't talk, but he's not interested in talking.
And so you all both said ki, we should have 8 hours of sleep, 8 hours of self-time and 8 hours of study. So we students approximately spend 8 hours in college. So our me time is compromised by studying at home. So what do we do?
8 hours are you studying or 8 hours you spending in the college?
8 hours of college and then...
8 hours of spending in the college or 8 hours are actually working at the college?
But we don't even have me time at college, right?
That's okay, but 8 hours of working or 8 hours in the college?
So approximately out of eight, we can at least study 4 hours of
three.
At college. Yeah, three.
So you still have 5 hours to work for.
So regarding the destructivity in daydreaming, what we can do is keep a rough page aside. If you have a wandering thought, you write it down over there and forget about it. Next technique is you go to what thought was running, then you go backtrack your thoughts. You come back to from where this thought started.
Yes, it's an excellent idea. In fact, this is one of the things which creative thinkers do. And what you're talking about is the mind map, where you tend to write down your words and then to backtrack and connect the dots and then come out with some solution, because this is something which is ongoing. I see a hand over there. Just speak into the mic. We are recording the whole thing.
Sir, at times, like, especially when I travel overseas, I see these students who are like around 16, 18, and they have stopped studying and they have started this independent living kind of a life and taking some small jobs. I at times wonder, why do we spend so many years in terms of working and then thinking about this thing, future mein security chahiye, isiliye hum ye job karenge. तो वो लाइफ अट्रैक्शन होता है तो बट देन इंडिया में बैक आते हैं उसके बाद लगता है कि नहीं हमें एक घर चाहिए फ्यूचर में घर नहीं रहेगा तो क्या होगा या जॉब परमानेंट जॉब नहीं रहा तो क्या होगा सो वी टेंड टू कॉम्प्रोमाइज़ विथ वॉट एवर वी आर इवन तो आई डोंट लाइक माई जॉब इन द नेम ऑफ सिक्योरिटी So this cultural conflict is there within me.
Well, what you're talking is universal. In fact, the youth today, what I'm being told by different professors, different teachers, there's a lot of insecurity and uncertainty amongst the youth. A, our societal structure is changing. They don't have the role models. B, there's always this thing, will I be able to establish myself? Will I be able to have a house, a decent income, a secure job? And then this creates a lot of uncertainty amongst the youth. They lose the focus on the current and they deviate sometimes onto various things, maybe anxiety disorders, depressive disorders, or even worse, into drug abuse and addictions. So this is what is actually the thing about the youth. And what you said, the problem is not about whether you are working as a student or not, because that's a cultural context difference over here. Where abroad, it's an independent style of living, where at the time of 18, the youth have to find their own place outside, whereas in India, over here, the youth tend to be sheltered by their parents. So that's a cultural difference. But globally, the youth are having a crisis today. They do not know which is the role model to follow. That's something which I've been told n number of times in Singapore, in Europe, and in India. Everywhere I'm having the same thing. Sir, you have any insights?
So the pendulum is swinging. Mm-hmm. In the US, more and more people in 30s and 40s have gone back to stay with their parents. Donald Trump is very unhappy because people who have gone to the US with Indian values are doing better than children who are basically Americans and not doing as well. There was a court ruling, Supreme Court ruling in California, which stopped the hospitals from putting railings around the children's beds in pediatric wards. 20 years later, the petitioner said that children's civil rights were being violated because there were railings on their bed. 20 years later, there was another Supreme Court ruling which enforced putting railings on the children's bed in pediatric wards of the hospital. So a psychiatrist went and studied the profile of the petitioners. And a whole lot of young petitioners who were not married 20 years ago, over the 20 years ago, had become parents. And now they wanted railings on the children's bed. So a lot comes with experience and learning, you know, fads, activism, and stable values. Human race had certain established values for years together. This strong culture of activism made people want to challenge established social norms. But after experience, we are going back to established social norms. The changing social trends, which are very dynamic, but again, the pendulum is swinging back to conservative life system.
So just a tiny question more. Is it okay to have a life where I keep on searching, to take a job and then I realize that this is not working with me, and then again switch over, or to go towards this idea of stick to one job? Again, that comes as a question.
Well, it actually depends on which stage of career you are in. At the early stage of your career, it doesn't matter. At a later stage of your career, your CV, everybody will have questions. This person doesn't stick to a job.
And whether it's a horizontal shift or a vertical shift, when you're changing from job to job, same level, or you're rising?
At times I have this question that I have one life. Why should I stick with one role? And then I start seeing.
I only have one life and just one wife. I don't know why it's secure. These are questions without answers. Yeah, recording it, ma'am, please.
The balance between the societal norms and the tradition and the culture and what you want to do in India, it seems like difficult. But still, I would say it's the matter of choice. You choose what you want to do. So India, that is the main problem, because...
Why is it difficult?
It is difficult because so many changing trends and the meanings and the definitions. For example, the marriage as an institution, the definition has changed. So for youth, it is difficult to choose what to do. And they, as a doctor said very rightly, there are no role models whom to follow.
When I was young, long, long ago, I was young, believe me. We had something called the sexual revolution, where people didn't want to be married, just live together and have fun as long as they wanted. Today, those same people who benefited or who had fun during the sexual revolution are now hardcore advocates of marriage as an institution. And the courts are now trying to bring laws that apply to marriage into living relationships. It's old wine in new bottle. You're trying to get the same thing done again. There has to be, like he said, lasting relationships, whether it's at work, whether it's in the family, whether it's within your own friend circle. So if you keep changing jobs, you're not going to have any lasting relationship, unless you are a cluster of people who keep changing jobs. If you keep changing your family structure, not have steady relationship, you are not going to have lasting relationship. Later on,
still
you're going
the
to regret.
Silver separation is still growing. I mean, they are celebrating the silver separation and not the silver anniversary or what say.
See, there's a blow to the ego. And then you want to somehow glamorize your wrong decisions. It's trying to fool yourself.
Thank you.
So you spoke about delegation of work, but yes. A lot of people, when I meet them and I deal with them, they have an issue delegating because they are not sure if the work would get done. And then they have that anxiety, ki maine isko bola hai. So that work is not getting done and they are not even doing the job. They took it in their hand. So how do you go about it?
Okay, you have a...
Like Ashutosh to work with.
No, you have... This is very common. What you are saying is not uncommon. It's called micromanagement. So this is a new boss who is not experienced, who doesn't trust his team, and it's reflecting in the fact that he doesn't want to give the job. Either he feels insecure that if I give it to them, they will claim credit, or they get the success and they will succeed him or her. So the core issue over here is of leadership. A good leader is the one who knows whom to delegate, what to delegate, and of course he takes credit when it's necessary, but allows the team to grow by delegation. So over here, I cannot comment on your specific case, but it's an issue of lack of trust and insecurity. And for that, of course, there's no solution. The only solution is find a boss who's willing to do this.
As a psychologist, so how do I work on the self-image of the person or the insecurities they are dealing with? How do I?
Well, it can be addressed if the person is amenable to listen. If this person has an adequate ego strength, it can be addressed that, hey, I want to do this work. And will you be willing to allow me to do this work under your guidance? Because this person doesn't want to lose control. Sometimes people don't want to lose control. They want to be in know-how of what's happening. Some people are perfectionists. They don't like to delegate. And they like the things to be done their way. You get their confidence. Okay, I will do it your way. But can I try this thing? Maybe we could. And if he's no. Okay, I will do it your way. But at least you get a chance to do it. So there, you have to see if the person is open to suggestion, willing to let you do the work, maybe under his close supervision, under his close guidance, but then you don't have a freedom. In essence, it's not delegation, it's just getting the work done through you. Yes, ma'am.
Doctor, just a comment. I'm very happy, Dr. Vihang, we couldn't comment on the last lecture, so I'd like to comment. It was a... You just hit the nail at the right place, because all these days we are talking about why this is happening and why that is happening, and I had the same answer, like, you know, because we are people are all running around in circles. That's what I look at. Everybody is running a rat's race. A woman is so educated today, and like, who would want to give up her career to look after her small kids? At least they need her at that age. At that time, and instead of giving quality time, she gives gadgets, and you know, ultimately we are blaming, you know, we are running around the same thing. So there, if I look at it 20 years back, these things were not happening. Today the world is gone to this extent, and I mean, what you spoke was very the truth about everything. And what I have to say is that ultimately, if I tell this to people today, like the youth or anybody, they say you are old-fashioned. You know, they talk about relationships are so easy, like, you know, they can, like, you know, the youth. And whether you talk about substance abuse, whatever I may say, they just have one word, that you are old-fashioned. My own people say that. So ultimately, I'm very happy at, doctor, like you said that. And I've been trying to say this. Think about the same thing what you spoke in all these days, where we are talking about so many things. But if you look back 20 years or many years back, these things were not happening. Even earlier, there was Adur Darshan. Now you get everything on the TV, right from condoms to everything is shown on media. So ultimately, what are the kids going to do? So that's,
right.
I mean, you,
let
you,
me provoke
really,
you.
Your thing was very good. And
let
I'm
me provoke you. When you had children, you had an option of whether or not to have a child.
Yes.
The child had no option of whether or not to have a parent.
Yeah.
So if you have willfully brought a child into this world, you're obliged to do what you need for the child. There is this old junk of quality time versus quantity time. That's rubbish. Children want the parents' time, full stop.
Yes.
Till they're in their teens. And once they are in their teens, they don't want the parents to interfere. One. Two, have you looked at a gardener? He spends all his time trying to bring up a nice flowering. He nurtures a plant. But when the flower grows, he's willing to let the flower go and have its own life. Parenting is like nurturing a flower plant. Once you have the good flower grown, don't stick to that flower, otherwise it will wither. Let the child have the child's own life. The second question is, a whole lot of us, when things go wrong, spend time in finding out who is at fault. Kya hua? Kaise hua? Kisne kiya? Are re? ऐसे कैसे किया, ऐसा नहीं होना चाहिए था. पॉइंट इज यू कैन नेवर गो बैक इन द पास्ट एंड चेंज द पास्ट. हुआ जो भी हुआ हुआ, आगे की सोचो, बी प्रोएक्टिव. मेंटल हेल्थ हैज चेंज्ड, साइकियाट्री हैज चेंज्ड फ्रॉम मेंटल इलनेस टू मेंटल हेल्थ. एंड टू कट अ वेरी स्टॉर्ट वेरी शॉर्ट लाइफ, प्रॉब्ली द लास्ट थिंग दैट आई वुड वॉन्ट टू से इज दिस परमा मॉडल ऑफ हैप्पीनेस, PERMA, परमा मॉडल. ऑलवेज थिंक पॉजिटिव. हुआ उसमें से आगे की सोचो, राइट? वॉट एवर दैट इज हैपेंड, आई विश इट डिडंट हैपन, बट लेट मी सी गेट सम लेसन आउट ऑफ इट. पी, ऑलवेज थिंक पॉजिटिव, विन विन. ई, कीप योर सेल्फ एंगेज्ड, डोंट बिकम अ काउच पटेटो और विदड्रॉ, बर्न आउट. नो, ऑलवेज कीप एंगेज्ड, डू थिंग्स दैट लाइक यू लाइक. अ होल लॉट ऑफ पीपल टर्न टू रिलीजन वंस दे आर माई एज, विच इज समथिंग वेरी गुड, और एक्सरसाइज वेन दे आर माई एज. ट्रबल इज वेन दे टर्न टू द नेबर्स वाइफ, देन देर इज प्रॉब्लम. सो कीप योर सेल्फ एंगेज्ड, एंगेज इन डूइंग थिंग्स विच आर मीनिंगफुल, विच आर एक्सेप्टेबल एंड विच आर पॉजिटिव. आर, रिलेशनशिप, ही सेड दैट सो वेल. मी एम, लुक एट मीनिंगफुलनेस इन योर लाइफ. That why do I want to survive? I want to survive because I want to do things. There's some meaning in my life. And A, think of your achievements, not your failures. I have whole lot of couples where after 25 years of marriage, the wife and the husband would say, we can't live with each other. So I said, he's this, he's that, she's this, she's that. So if the couple is so bad, how did the marriage survive 25 years? That was something good. So actually one wife came and said, doctor, I thought over what you said, and the only good thing about my husband is that his in-laws are better than my in-laws. But that's not true. There are two kinds of memories in our life, happy memories and sad memories. The unhappy memories are glutamate-mediated. Glutamate-mediated memories get engraved on the coconut. Happy memories are GABA-mediated. They get erased. Whenever something happens, all the unhappy things will just kind of flooding your memory. ऐसा किया, वैसा किया, शादी करना, सासू ने ऐसा किया. हैप्पी मेमोरीज यू गॉट टू स्क्रैच योर कोकोनट टू रिमेंबर. सो ट्राई एंड रिमेंबर द हैप्पी मेमोरीज, डोंट गेट स्वेड बाय द अनहैप्पी मेमोरीज. ओवरकम योर ओन नेगेटिव फिजियोलॉजी, दैट्स द परमा मॉडल. इट्स नॉट माइन, इट इज समबडी
एल्सेस. लास्ट क्वेश्चन, इफ यू हैव अ क्वेश्चन, यू.
My question is for Dr. Ashutosh. It's like a personal thing. In my, I'm from a government organization. In last 10 years, I have seen 5 bosses changing, 5 different styles of governance. Like you said, the boss might be insecure, might be good for delegation and all. But it confuses a lot. And still, they say this government is like a centipede. Uske pair kaat do, to bhi chal raha hai. But ultimately, what should be the situation in that case? When you know that the boss is going to stay for 1 or 2 years, retire होके जाने ही वाला है, and the one who is on top always वो ऐसा 55, 60s में ही आने वाला है, तो what the other people do and where is the chance for growth for them then?
I'm glad you asked this question because this bring us to the point where we have this things which are beyond our control. We have a sphere of influence and we have something which is completely under our control. So things which are beyond our control is who becomes the boss, how long does he stay, what is his style of management. Our sphere of influence is, let's see, is this boss amenable to our suggestion? What is in our control is our reaction. Do I stay true to myself, true to my job, and try and be as productive as possible no matter what the boss is? Sometimes the boss doesn't trust me, I get upset. Can I control my reaction to this and yet stay productive over here? So this is all that I can tell you, because we cannot have complete control over what happens outside. We need to control what happens inside us and still stay as productive as we can be.
The only job in this world, to my mind, which has no problems, no stresses, and being completely predictable of your role, is to be a dispatch clerk in a central government office. Any job other than being a dispatch clerk in a government office will have its insecurities, uncertainties, and learn to enjoy them.
And sir, if I can add, I'm most pleased to have you here, my good my guru and my friend, my wife over here, and my brother attending this. So it's a close relationship for me which matters, and of course you lovely audience who took time on your Friday evening to be attending to this lecture, even if it was slightly deviating from psychiatry, but this was in the purview of a positive psychiatry. So thank you very much, and I wish you a pleasant day ahead.